Good morning. Okay. So I hope you will understand me. You have the translator with you. We will talk about pulmonary hypertension in COPD, and this will be the okay, so there.
Second. I'm going to associate with
that. Okay. You will, how will I manipulate from here?
Am I?
Okay. Okay, so we'll talk about pulmonary hypertension in COPD. We have the new classification for pulmonary hypertension. We group it into 5. And pulmonary hypertension due to chronic lung diseases would be group 3. Group 2, due to left heart disease like congestive heart failure, is still the most common cause for pulmonary hypertension. But we will be talking about group 3. Group 3 pulmonary hypertension due to chronic lung diseases will have COPD as the most common cause of pulmonary hypertension, and that's what we will talk about. So if you have a COPD patient with you, you will consider pulmonary hypertension being present if the resting mean pulmonary artery pressure is 25 and above. Who among you have patients who underwent right heart catheterization already? Please raise your hand. So very few. This is the gold standard. But it is not possible most often, so we use the 2D echo. Now, on the 2D echo, we need to have a tricuspid regurgitant jet for us to have a pressure gradient, and that we will measure, that will now be an approximate of your pulmonary artery systolic pressure. That is just an estimate of the right heart catheterization pulmonary artery pressure, but that will be good enough for us. So we say there is pulmonary hypertension if it's 25 and above, and we say it is severe pulmonary hypertension if it's more than 35. So this also, we also call it out of proportion pulmonary hypertension in COPD. So look at the prevalence. If we talk about pulmonary hypertension in COPD, it can range from 2.7% to 91%. So it is a common phenomenon among our COPD patients. But severe pulmonary hypertension is not common. It only occurs up to 9.8% if you make sure that there is no left-sided heart failure. Because if there is left-sided heart failure, you can have many cases of pulmonary hypertension. The severe out-of-proportion pulmonary hypertension in COPD would be those cases without left-sided heart failure. Now, what would be the impact if you now diagnose your patient with COPD to have pulmonary hypertension? They will have a poorer prognosis. They will have more exacerbations, they will do worse on exercise, they have a higher mortality rate. If they have severe pulmonary hypertension, their survival rate is 36% compared to 62% survival rate for mild pulmonary hypertension in COPD. Now, why do they develop pulmonary hypertension? Our usual mechanism that we think about would be what? Alveolar hypoxia, correct? So if there is hypoxemia, then we believe that will be the main cause for pulmonary hypertension in COPD. But if you look at this diagram, you can see many other mechanisms there. So they are seeing now, so this diagram shows why we develop pulmonary hypertension from hypoxemia, it's because of the potassium channels there that are blocked by the hypoxia. But if you look at it, cigarette smoking by itself can cause a lot of inflammation and trigger now chronic pulmonary hypertension in our patients. So most often, if our patients are more hypoxemic, the greater their chance to develop pulmonary hypertension. But there are many cases, though, that will not be within this usual pattern. Some will have pulmonary hypertension when they do not have hypoxia. And why does this happen? Because of these different mechanisms that we see here. Airflow limitation can cause pressure swings and affect the blood vessels in the lungs. Systemic and lung inflammation definitely can cause a lot of vascular remodeling. So they think the main problem would, of course, be the vascular remodeling in the airways, in the blood vessels in the lungs. And these three cellular mechanisms that we know are present in pulmonary arterial hypertension as a whole would be the same mechanisms that are stimulated in COPD as well. So we talk about the nitric oxide pathway, the endothelin 1 receptor pathway, and the prostacycline pathway. These are all stimulated by the inflammation and the hypoxia also. And these now become our pharmacologic targets, the drug targets now to address pulmonary hypertension in COPD. So this, the two panels here, the two panels there would be your the pathology of pulmonary hypertension in COPD, whereas the one, the left panel there, would be your pathology in your idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. We know that's the plexiform lesions, whereas in COPD, there would be intimal and medial hypertrophy there. What is the implication there? The pulmonary hypertension in COPD is not that high compared to your idiopathic causes and to your group 4 causes or even group 5 causes. But still, as we mentioned, you will have some 9% cases who will have severe pulmonary hypertension. So if you compare now the levels of pulmonary artery pressure, they might be lower in your COPD patient. So how does pulmonary hypertension develop in a COPD patient? It's usually very slow. Some, as I mentioned, will not even reach significant levels. So here we can see that sometimes the pressures can increase just as low as 0.5 millimeter mercury per year, rise in pulmonary artery pressure. And in case they develop pulmonary hypertension, usually it would be 7 years down the line, starting from the diagnosis of COPD. But once it is present, we have to be careful because that means a poorer prognosis for our COPD patient. So, as I mentioned, severe pulmonary hypertension is what number? 35 and above. They would have a poorer prognosis. The other term is out of proportion pulmonary hypertension in COPD. Look at their profile. Their lung function is actually better than those with mild pulmonary hypertension. Some might have actually lower levels of PaCO2. The compensatory mechanism probably can even, they say, be an indication that there is something else going on. So they're considering it might be a different phenotype. Some are theorizing that maybe it's a mix between a group 1 pulmonary artery hypertension in a COPD patient. They're just together in one patient. So that's one theory of some of the experts. We had a case report in the Philippines of a young male, but he was a heavy smoker, 60-pack years, and we tested him for TB. Schistosoma is very frequent in the Philippines. He was negative for that. We worked him up for connective tissue diseases. He was also negative. And just with usual COPD treatment, and here we gave ICS-LABA, his pulmonary artery pressure improved. We did not do a right heart catheterization in this case. We just did a TEE for this case. So how do we work up our patients with pulmonary hypertension in COPD? This would be the usual route. A diagnosed COPD patient manifesting with more shortness of breath compared to the usual, having signs probably of right-sided heart failure, then you have to now make sure first there is no left-sided heart failure. That is the first thing that we have to rule out. And then rule out sleep apnea syndrome, presence of interstitial lung disease, or even pulmonary embolism or CTEPH. Once you've ruled that out and you still are stuck with a patient with pulmonary hypertension, they would recommend us referring to an expert who can do right heart catheterization to have the gold standard in confirming the diagnosis. But if it's not possible, then of course we go ahead and just proceed with treatment for our patients. So bottom line, at present, 2018, they have now the new consensus by the German pulmonologists and cardiologists, so I will show it later. But all in all, everybody still agrees, even in the GOLD guidelines, that if you label a patient to be having pulmonary hypertension in COPD, what is the treatment of choice? Still treat the underlying disease. That's the bottom line. So here, optimal treatment would be the underlying disease. Make sure the comorbidities have been ruled out, especially left-sided heart failure. And Professor Hung will talk about that more later. And then, as we mentioned, it portends a poor prognosis. Therefore, if lung transplant is available in your country, then they have to be now started to be a candidate for lung transplant because your primary treatment will be the underlying disease. And there is limited data now in terms of vasodilator therapy. We will talk about that more. This is the one I mentioned, the newest guideline. It just came out last month. So optimal treatment of the underlying disease is still the treatment of choice for pulmonary hypertension in COPD. Direct or specific pulmonary arterial hypertension drugs are not recommended for patients with pulmonary hypertension due to lung diseases, but there might be people who would respond to these, and we'll talk about that more. This comes from our textbook, and still we believe in this. So for all patients, we do the following measures. And for selected patients, your anticoagulation there, digoxin, we'll talk about it, lung volume reduction surgery, iron supplementation, we'll also do that. Okay, so long-term oxygen therapy first. So let's look at this side, at the slides here. This would still be the most important treatment if your patient is hypoxemic. So of course we know 15 hours minimum of giving oxygen. That has been shown to improve the survival of patients and lower down the pulmonary artery pressure. But they have seen many cases where even if patients were on oxygen therapy, their pressure still remained high. Their functional capacity improved, but not that much. So they believe that it's not just purely hypoxemia, which is the cause of pulmonary hypertension. In this study, they combined nitric oxide and oxygen together, and this is where they found a decrease in the pulmonary artery pressure when the two were combined compared to just giving oxygen alone. So it seems just giving oxygen therapy may not be enough for some of the patients who would have pulmonary hypertension. Now, here at the right side or at your left side, these are the other therapeutic strategies I'm sure you are doing to your patients with pulmonary hypertension or right-sided heart failure. Many among you would give diuretics probably, so that is okay. Anticoagulation is not really recommended as of now. There's no data unless you have pulmonary embolism or they are at risk. And then digoxin at present is not really recommended unless you think that this would now be better for rate control, for example. Calcium channel blockers are not useful in pulmonary hypertension in COPD, and phlebotomy can be done if your patient is manifesting with severe polycythemia of hematocrit of more than 55. So now they are cautioning us in using pulmonary vasodilators. Why? You think about the physiology now. So when your patient has pulmonary, for example, hypoxemia, there is the reflex pulmonary vasoconstriction so that your VQ mismatch, your VQ now will be matched better. And when you dilate now, as you can see here, your lungs are still destroyed. You get a worse VQ mismatch. and you can worsen hypoxemia in some cases. So they saw that in some calcium channel blocker studies and in some pulmonary vasodilator studies also. So we will talk about that more later. Some would give iron infusion. What's the rationale behind that? So you increase, of course, the oxygen carrying capacity for patients, and they've seen that also improve some patients with hypoxemia. Lung transplant, definitely. Presence of pulmonary hypertension in a COPD patient who's now very dyspneic is one of the indications to have your patients as candidate for lung transplant. And they've seen the pulmonary artery pressure improve, of course, with lung transplant. Now, how about lung volume reduction surgery? Do you do lung volume reduction surgery here in Vietnam? Who has had patients who had LVRS done for their patients? Me, I stopped only up to 3 patients. How about you, Professor Hung?
We have some case for intrabronchial valve.
Valve. You need yes, valve. But not that many patients.
No, not many.
Yes. So pulmonary hypertension before was a contraindication to doing lung volume reduction surgery because you are further depleting the vascular bed if you're now obstructing those parts of the lungs. But at present, they're now seeing data where lung volume reduction surgery with a mechanical improvement in the work of breathing of the patient somehow improve also the VQ match of your patients, and they have seen a decrease actually in the pulmonary artery pressure among patients who underwent lung volume reduction surgery. So this is changing now. We will go now to the use of PAH or pulmonary arterial hypertension specific therapy, or pulmonary vasodilators. So remember the 3 signaling pathways I mentioned? Those will be the things that we'll be talking about. Prostacycline pathway, so prostacycline agonist or similar to them, derivatives or prostanoids as they call them. Endothelin receptor antagonists, and the 3 would be the nitric oxide pathway. So under the nitric oxide pathway would be nitric oxide by itself, and the other one would be your Riociguat medicine. I haven't tried that yet. It's not available in the Philippines. So in our GOLD guidelines, again, bottom line, vasodilators are not first line for pulmonary hypertension in COPD. In fact, they want us not to use it because of the worsening of the VQ mismatch. But in some cases, they might respond, and that's what we have to consider for some cases. So first, we'll discuss the endothelin receptor antagonist, your bosentan. So many are, you have bosentan here, correct? Yes. And then there have been 2 studies on bosentan use in pulmonary hypertension in COPD, and one of them is this study here. They saw that there was an improvement in pulmonary artery pressure, but look, there is a worsening of the gas exchange. So these are one of the reasons why they are not recommending it as first line, because it can worsen your hypoxemia in some cases. How about sildenafil? We like this a lot for pulmonary hypertension due to other causes. It can be tried also for pulmonary hypertension in COPD. So far, these are the 3 trials, and I will show you the most recent done by Dr. Vitulo later. This is one of the trials on sildenafil by Ritma et al. In 2008. This is a very small study, 15 patients only. They gave sildenafil at 50 milligrams 3 times a day for 12 weeks. And they found that there was no improvement in terms of functional capacity. However, at least the gas exchange problem, the hypoxemia did not worsen here. The PA pressure went down a little, but they did not see the patient-related outcomes that they wanted here. This is the most recent study on sildenafil. It is a randomized trial, but look at the numbers, only 28 patients. So far, we don't have big studies on sildenafil for PH in COPD. So how did they give sildenafil? 20 TID for 16 weeks, of course, compared to placebo. And they found good results here. Pulmonary artery pressure went down, functional capacity of the patients improved with sildenafil use, and the gas exchange problems that we are scared of did not happen to these patients. So there might be patients who can respond to this if they, their pulmonary hypertension continues despite regular treatment for COPD. Tadalafil is another drug, a PDE5 inhibitor. The results here were again equivocal. There was no improvement in exercise endurance in these patients. How about iloprost? So this would be your inhaled prostacycline similar drug or agonist. So it's like prostacycline. How do they give it? It's just a one-time thing that they would give in the nebulized form. And they saw that gas exchange improved among patients with pulmonary hypertension after the iloprost nebulization, and there was no worsening of gas exchange. And this is the most recent study on iloprost here. Again, only 67 patients here. It was an open label trial, so no RCT yet on inhaled iloprost. And this is how they gave it. So 20 micrograms of iloprost through an ultrasonic neb. This is how they gave it. And again, they saw an improvement in exercise endurance, and oxygen did not drop among these patients who were given iloprost. So that can be given. The riociguat is acts on the soluble guanyl cyclase, and then again, it still acts through the nitric oxide pathway. I haven't used it. There's one study which shows that there was an improvement in pulmonary artery pressures, but no change in lung function. This is a tablet, and they just gave it for 2 days here. So this drug is already part and parcel of the usual treatment for group 1 pulmonary arterial hypertension. Nitric oxide. So again, this is inhaled. It is a one-time administration. And so far, the studies, again, are very small. This was a poster presentation in the 2018 ATS convention, and they showed here an improvement in terms of pulmonary artery pressure again and 6-minute walk test. But again, this is not considered first-line drug for pulmonary hypertension in COPD. Now, there are 3 studies where they combine everything. They did a retrospective analysis among patients who were given medications to decrease pulmonary arterial hypertension in COPD. So this is the Fossati retrospective study. Another one was done in France. Another one was done in the US under the ASPIRE registry. More or less, the signal turns out to be positive in terms of giving PDE5 inhibitors, giving endothelin receptor antagonists, but these are retrospective studies and they are not really controlled trials. They show that there is an improvement in pulmonary artery pressure and there is an improvement in functional capacity, but again, these are all small studies and these are not RCTs. So finally, this is a meta-analysis which looked at bosentan and sildenafil. So your endothelin receptor antagonist and PDE5 in combination. And more or less, they've seen that these drugs somehow really improve exercise capacity and decrease pulmonary arterial pressure and did not worsen really the hypoxemia that much. So we're getting mixed signals now. We need bigger studies, but so far there is a positive result or outcome in most of the small studies, though. We need bigger studies to really give a definite recommendation. So this is the most recent recommendation how to proceed with treatment for pulmonary hypertension in COPD by that group, German group. They published it, as I mentioned, last month. So for patients who have relatively good lung function, and of course their PA pressures are okay, no need, of course, to give your pulmonary hypertension medications. But if they would be 25 already, mild pulmonary hypertension, and you are still not sure as to what the reason is, of course, you rule out your differentials. Still try to avoid giving your direct or PAH-specific drug. If they have severe pulmonary hypertension, though, their lung function is good, you have to make sure that there is no group 1 combined disease in that patient, and you might try giving your PAH medications. For COPD patients who have poor lung function and they have mild pulmonary hypertension, how do you treat them? Treat still the underlying disease. And they would say currently there is no data to support treatment with PAH drugs. But again, we look at the patient. If they still proceed to have to be very symptomatic, their hypertension still persists, it might be an option for us. And if it's really high, the pressure is 35 and above, then kindly refer to your specialist so they can do right heart catheterization. The professor before me, I think, can do that. So they can treat the patient more adequately and consider, of course, transplant for those patients. So to conclude, pulmonary hypertension in COPD, is it common? Yes, it is common, can be at up to 90% of your patients. But severe pulmonary hypertension, 35 millimeters and above, is rare, up to 9% only. And if it's present, you still treat according to the guidelines, the underlying COPD. Rule out other causes. Give long-term oxygen therapy if hypoxemia is the main cause of the pulmonary hypertension. And then if they persist to be having pulmonary hypertension, then you can consider giving specific treatment for the pulmonary hypertension. But if possible, try to document it with right heart catheterization if possible. And here, you have to consider also the possibility of your patient being a combined group 1 patient with concomitant COPD. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Và rất cảm ơn bà Phó sư Phết Tăng Đê đã có trình bày về điều trị tăng áp phổi.